So, if you're like me, you might end up with a lot of hand planes. But don't be like me. I have a problem. Just because I own a million planes doesn't mean you need to. Actually, you can get a lot of woodwork done with just three common, easy-to-find planes. Having a number 5, a number 4, and a block plane will let you handle a wide variety of woodworking projects. Out of all of these, the number 5 is probably the most complicated, so we'll talk about this one first. The Stanley number 5 is often referred to as a jack plane, because it's kind of a jack of all trades. You can't do everything with one, but just having a jack plane will handle most of the tasks you would even own a plane for in the first place. A lot of woodworkers set up their jack plane with a heavy curve to the iron, called a camber. For a jack plane, the camber is usually 8 to 10 inches. That's a lot, and it takes off big chunks of wood. In this configuration, the jack plane is known as a 4 plane, not to be confused with a number 4 plane. We'll talk about that in a minute. In this case, 4 is actually a shortening of the word before, because the 4 plane touches the wood before any other planes do. Let's say I have a board like this, and I need to make it thinner and take off a lot of material, maybe a quarter or even a half inch. Sawing this, especially with a handsaw, would be really tedious and difficult. But a 4 plane, a jack plane set up with a camber, can take big, wide strokes. You can see that the chips that come off of it aren't even like shavings. They're much thicker. I can even set the plane more deeply than I already have and be more aggressive. Now you might notice that I'm going across the grain here, and again, with a cambered iron, that's actually fine. The curvature of the blade will help keep it from tearing out. Now I've only taken 3 or 4 passes across the board, but because my chips are so heavy, I'm actually already almost down to my line. The cambered iron has left a very scalloped surface. It's really rough, so I'll take the same plane and run with the grain. Now the board is very close to the thickness that I want, and it's also relatively flat and level. I can use the side of the plane like a straight edge and see that there are very few spots that need further attention. I did all of this with just my 4 plane. Now, I'll take the exact same plane, pull out the cambered iron, and replace it with a much straighter iron. This one has a very, very light curvature to it, just enough to keep the corners from digging in. When I drop this iron in and get it properly adjusted, the plane's capable of doing much finer work. I take it to the board that I just leveled with the 4 plane, and quickly, I'm taking nice, wide, relatively thin shavings, and the surface that I'm leaving behind, well, it's surprisingly good. Now let's say this board was done and dimensioned, but I needed a board that was much wider, so I had to glue something else to this to make a larger panel. Well, the jack plane works for that too. I can take the same blade that I used a second ago, the straight one with a tiny bit of camber, and use that to joint the edge. I hold the plane like this, take one good stroke across. Sometimes it takes a few tries to get a continuous shaving, but as soon as you get a full length, full width shaving like the one I have here, you know that the board is completely straight and flat. Now I can take another board with a jointed edge, line them up, and glue them, and make a larger panel. So if the jack plane's so good, why should we even have another bench plane? Can't the jack just handle everything? Well, unfortunately, it's not that simple. Because the jack plane has a long sole, it makes an okay smoother, but not a great one. Let's look at the board I was just working on. You can see that the surface of this board is good, but it's not perfect. There's a little bit of tear out here. There's some thick gouges left over from the cambered blade here and here, and you can actually see some tracks, places where the edge of the jack plane blade bit in a little bit to the wood. Because of all of these things, we really need one more plane for our general prep, and that's the number 4 plane, the smoother. Compared to the number 5, the 4 is almost exactly the same. It's just shorter. The reason for the short sole is that when you're trying to smooth work, the plane won't ride as much over the high spots. It'll go in and out of the different surfaces left over by the larger planes and smooth out any small, rough areas. Here's the same board, and I haven't done anything to it since I used the jack on it a minute ago. Now, I'm going to take my number 4 plane and go over it using overlapping strokes. Now, I'm going to back the iron off and go over it again, taking a thinner shaving. I'm not sure how much of this comes through on camera, but the surface I have on this board now is glass smooth. It doesn't have any scratches or gouges. I could either sand it with 220, or I might even be able to go straight to finish. And most of that is because of my smoothing plane. The last plane you need is a block plane. They're little, and they're very common, but they're actually kind of difficult to buy. Unlike the number 4 and the number 5, which are pretty much the same no matter when they were made or who made them, Stanley and their competitors made dozens and dozens of different models of block plane. They're different sizes, all kinds of different features. Some of them work very well, some of them not so much. So finding one that's actually going to work well for a price you can afford can be sort of complicated. And with block planes, it's actually more important what you don't buy than what you do buy. This little plane here is actually a perfect example of what not to get. This is a block plane made by Sargent, and it's very similar to another common model called the Stanley 110. Now, I used to have a 110, but I got rid of it, and that should tell you something. For me to actually sell a plane, it must have been a piece of crap. Now, it's not that planes like this one don't work. They work fine. The problem is that they don't have any adjustment features. Believe it or not, the craftsman who bought one of these would actually take a small hammer, like this one, tap the back of the blade to advance it, and tap this little nub back here to pull it back. Shifting the blade side to side was done just by tapping the sides of it. Now, anybody can learn how to do this, and you'd probably get good at it, but there's no reason to. It's a giant pain, and there are plenty of other block planes that work much better than this one and are still cheap. Here's another block plane that would be a big step up from a completely manual plane like the 110 or the little Sargent that I just showed you. This is the Stanley 220. It's a little bit bigger and a little bit wider. It has a cam-operated cap that's very easy to take on and off and tensions the blade really securely. It also has this nice big knurled knob in back, which lets you very easily dial in exactly the amount of blade that you want coming through the sole here at the mouth. Now, this plane isn't perfect, it doesn't have any mechanism for adjusting the blade side to side, and it also has a fixed mouth. That's a feature we'll talk about in just a second. So, overall, this plane is only decent, but that being said, it's pretty decent, especially because they're not collectible. So you're not going to be competing against people who want to buy one of these and just stick it up on the shelf. You can find them at flea markets and tag sales all over the place, and they're pretty inexpensive. A couple of dollars is a good price to pay. We'll finish up by talking about my two favorite block planes, the number 18 and the 9.5. These were both top-of-the-line planes when Stanley manufactured them, and they still work really well today. Now, both of these are collectibles, so sometimes the prices are higher, but Stanley also made thousands and thousands and thousands of them, so it's still pretty easy to find them cheaply. What these planes have in common is that they have lots of adjustment features. Both of them have a little wheel in the back here that you run up and down a shaft, which advances and retracts the blade. It's an easy system, and it works really well. They also both have a lateral adjustment lever. This lever back here moves the blade side to side and makes it easy to get a square cut. The other thing that both of these planes have are adjustable mouths. So I'll set this one up so you can see what's going on, and I'll adjust this one. The knob in front also loosens this front toe section right here, which slides in and out on tracks. There's a lever that you move side to side. When I loosen this one and move the lever, you should be able to see the mouth of the plane opening and closing. It's a great little mechanism. And in practice, what it allows you to do is set the plane for exactly the mouth you need for whatever you're doing. A fine mouth for difficult woods or taking a thin cut, and a wider mouth for when you're doing coarser work. With these three different adjustment features, depth, lateral, and the adjustable mouth, these two planes, and anything that's similar to them, will do pretty much anything you need in a block plane. Of course, that does bring up the question of what do we even need a block plane for anyway? Well, a lot of things. For one, the block plane is very small, so you can use it one-handed, and you can use it on small pieces of work. This is a little piece of very hard maple, and I might have a difficult time balancing a large smoothing plane on it. But if I need to true up this surface, my little block plane stays balanced, takes nice shavings, and leaves a good surface. They're also good for detail work. So for instance, this edge is very sharp, and I could do an accurate chamfer on it just by running my block plane along it several times, slowly making a wider and wider ledge until I have a nice, crisp, even chamfer all the way along the edge. Now, most people use block planes most of the time for end grain. The chamfering that I was able to do on the long grain is just as easy to do across this end grain. And that's a task that a lot of planes would struggle with. The block plane does it no problem. At this point, I hope I've convinced you that it's a good idea to go out and buy a jack plane, at least, if not the other ones. But we should probably talk about money. Now, I usually pay around $5 for a jack plane. It's the most common plane in existence, and Stanley probably made millions of them. That's not an exaggeration. They're not very collectible, so it shouldn't be difficult to find one cheap. Now, a number 4 can be a little bit harder to find, but they're still extremely common. They're the second most common plane ever produced, so I would still only spend a few dollars on one of these. Block planes can be a little bit trickier. Because they're little and they're cute, a lot of people tend to think that they're worth money. Sometimes they are, and sometimes they aren't. Maybe you'll spend a little bit more for a block plane. If it's one of the ones that's fully adjustable, like we've been discussing, then maybe it's worth spending $10 on it, especially if the condition is decent. Overall, I think you should shoot to spend about 20 bucks for all three of the planes that I've been talking about today. Now, these aren't eBay prices, and they aren't antique store prices either. These are flea market prices, tag sale prices, maybe even Craigslist. Another really good idea is just to put the word out among your friends that you're looking for old tools. These things are literally everywhere, and you never know who's got grandpa's tools sitting rusting in the basement. I've actually gotten a lot of mine for free from people who just wanted to get rid of them. So of course, you're ready now to run out and buy your first number 5. But there could be one more problem. Let's say you find this number 5 and this number 5. And they're both for a good price. Which one do you buy? Well, that's not easy, but we'll talk about it next week. Thanks for watching.